Starting to come into the venue and fill up into the arena outside. Today we are crowning the fittest man and woman on the planet. We've got a full day of exciting competition. Welcome at our day at the games desk. You can see some of the athletes warming up with the cheese curd in the back room. If you haven't had enough cheese curds already, we're going to bring some more to you in just a second. Here at the day at the games, joined alongside Daniel Beef Pillows Bailey and Brooke Entz, we're bringing you guys all of the latest updates on the competition. We're going to bring you guys some analysis from yesterday as well. Day three of competition was exciting, to say the least. What are some surprises? What stood out to you in the competition yesterday?
I watched both the men and the women, and Cody Anderson is so impressive. So impressive. Watching him finish the workout and hit that last bar, two reps, was amazing. And to watch him fail one and then get it was even better. It's always good to see someone who is considered maybe to be like an underdog in some sort of event, or, you know, he's like a smaller athlete, dominate, for him, like, dominate that workout. He did so well.
Right, he made it look super clean. It was awesome. It was impressive to watch, especially from my standpoint, knowing some of those weights. Some of the things I loved yesterday, obviously the lead change, the tight changes between on the women's side. It's exciting to see. There's so many good athletes at the top that could be on the podium or take the top spot. The Fikowski-Frazier battle and the strongman sphere was a highlight of mine. And also seeing Bridges get a second place finish last night, a little bit more back to himself. He got that big roar out at the finish line that we're used to seeing and we haven't seen all weekend, so I was excited to perform for that.
Nice to see Josh Bridges doing what he normally does and what we expected from him this weekend. But we're going to start by taking a look back at what happened with the team competition yesterday. And one thing was clear, that the Wasatch CrossFit Brutes are here playing for keeps. They were just impressive wire to wire in day number three.
Yeah, Mayhem can catch them, right? It's not out of the scope of what can happen for this last day. Top finishes are what matter. Froning has been the guy who's kind of blazing the trail for first for the past 6 years with individual and team. Will it end this weekend?
It's very possible. Wasatch CrossFit have won three of the last four events. They beat their closest competitor, CrossFit Mayhem, in five straight events. And it's very possible that we could see for the first time in 6 years, Rich Froning not standing on top of the podium. An impressive performance from both teams, but still plenty of opportunity for Mayhem to climb their way back into the top spot for the teams. We saw Rich earlier in the Big Bob event looking pretty tired. I know that event took a toll on these teams, but here are your overall standings after 3 days of competition for the teams. Wasatch CrossFit in first, 60 points ahead of CrossFit Mayhem. Then a tight race for the third and final podium spot. CrossFit Fort Vancouver holding onto it right now, but look down, third through eighth, separated by just 32 points. So any one of those teams theoretically could jump up into that final spot for the teams. Now, we saw an exciting race yesterday for the women's competition. It's arguably been the marquee race for the weekend. And two women really established themselves last night in the final event, in Tia Claire Toomey and Cara Webb.
From the get-go of that workout, they were ready to go, they were ready to win, and they showed that. Their pace was fast. And honestly, when you're in that predicament, when you have someone racing you, and it's kind of your change in the leads back and forth, it takes one split second of a mindset change to just give it up. And neither of them did that. And honestly, I wouldn't have expected it from Tia, but because of her performance last year, she did have that mindset change a little bit in the middle of the competition. That didn't happen this year, and that's a mindset of a champion.
Yep, and you heard it from Cara Webb. It was awesome to see two Aussie chickies out there front running in that particular event. It was a great race to close out day number three, and it's going to be exciting to see which one of those two ladies could possibly seize control starting the day as well. And here are their placements over the last couple of days. They've clearly been the two best in the field since day number two. Look at Cara Webb up top. Her last six events, three firsts and 2 seconds, and then an eighth place finish. That's not too shabby. Tia been pretty balanced throughout. She's got 3 second place finishes along with 2 event wins as well. But the fight for third on the women's side is also very heated, and a few of these athletes are still within earshot of possibly taking the top spot. But it starts with Sarah, it starts with Annie, and it starts with Tennille, three women who have been pretty impressive throughout. And Sarah Sigmund's daughter, despite slipping down the leaderboard, has had an impressive weekend thus far.
She's had an impressive weekend, and I think, you know, the event 11, she has a chance to really keep that little bit of cushion that she has, which will set her up nicely for solidifying, third place finish this weekend.
Yep.
But Annie's right there, and Annie is also going to do really well on event 11. And Tennille, I mean, she did take a 22nd on the last event, which is not good trying to get a podium spot. But you see Annie took a 21st, but she had three third place finishes. Kara Webb took a 23rd, but she had three first place finishes. You just can't place outside, that far outside the top 10, unless you can win events if you want a podium at the end of the weekend.
Nice to see a little bit of the Annie of old. She's had a bit of a resurgence this year after 2 years of some disappointing finishes. And Tennille Reed-Berline having a fantastic sophomore campaign. We saw she was actually the overall leader heading up into the Muscle Up Clean Ladder. You see her wearing that white leader's jersey. Had a little bit of a slip and not the finish that she wanted to close out day number two with a 22nd place finish in heavy 17.5. But you know what? She's been hanging tough all weekend. She still has a shot. She's definitely in the hunt for the podium. So an impressive weekend from her nonetheless.
And I would absolutely love to see that the American flag on that podium this year.
Yeah,
I really would. As much as I love our Australian chickies.
Yep. You look at the top 10 there, and it's actually a pretty nice spread there of country flags across the board. Tia Claire Toomey has a 14-point edge over Kara Webb. Sarah Sigmund's daughter, Annie Thor's daughter, Tennille Reed, all within the hunt. Two-time reigning champ, Katrin Davis' daughter, sits in sixth. Now we're going to head over to the men's competition and Matt Fraser. It's basically been a one-man show from the get-go. He is led wire to wire.
Yeah, he's absolutely tearing it up. Again, started off incredibly well on that run, swim, run, which we don't expect. We do expect him to do very well in lifting, which he did. Super consistent. Not a win there, but another great place for him to grab some points.
Matt Fraser, one of the best in the business at pistols. He just looks like just a machine on those events. The Triple G Chipper was really one of those events where he just kind of put his foot down and announced to the rest of the world that, you know, you're just playing for second. Even in the double banger, after what was probably his worst finish since the deadlift ladder at the ranch, didn't really faze him that much. He bounced back with a second strongman spear, a first in the muscle up clean ladder. We see him finishing there under the lights of the Coliseum. And then another first in heavy 17.5. Two firsts and a second to close out day number three. And right now, he just has an absolute monster lead. Super impressive from Matt Fraser, not just performing well, but when we expect him to win, going out and just following that up by actually winning.
Yeah, I expected him to do really well, but I'm blown away at how well he's doing.
Yeah, we see a comparison here. This is just, you know, a jumping off point just to see Rich Froning, the best to ever do it. Matt Fraser trying to work his way up in the conversation. Four appearances from Matt, five from Rich, and pretty comparable stats across the board. The one difference being the championships, but it looks like Matt is well on his way towards adding another win in that championship column. But the race for the podium is still heating up between Noah Olsen, Brent Fikowski, and Ricky Garrard. But Noah, moving up into second on day number three, is having himself a very consistent, albeit quiet, weekend.
That's exactly what I was going to say. It's a pretty quiet move, but look at where he's sitting. He's in a great spot to finish out the day. Did an excellent job hitting that last clean on the clean ladder, whereas competitor Fikowski, we'll see in a minute, couldn't hit it. But he's just been super consistent. You don't see a lot of struggle in his face. In the past, we've kind of seen him get really frustrated. He's not showing any of that. He's just getting the work done, doing what he needs to do, taking those top 10 finishes.
Three of his last four events finishes have been in the top five, and that moves him up into second. But arguably the rookie of the year, Ricky Garrard, kicked things off on day number one with an event win. He's been hanging tough in the top five all weekend long. You know, it didn't matter what we've thrown at him, a cyclocross, a heavy snatch, the assault banger. He is hung tough with the best in this sport. Certainly impressive from the young rookie. He's kind of had a few disappointing finishes to close out day number three in 17.5. His worst finish is only one outside of the top 30. But you know what? After 3 days of competition, you're in fourth place overall. You're in the conversation for the podium. Not much more you can ask for from the rookie.
No, incredible job by Ricky.
Yep. And then Brent Fikowski, the guy who's actually sitting in the third and final podium spot. This kind of is the MO last year as well. He performs really well in some events, top three finishes, an event win, a couple of event wins this year to give him six overall. You can see him having a good time out on the floor, but a couple of bad finishes as well. It's really kind of been his Achilles heel. A 31st place finish in the Triple G Chipper, and then a 22nd place finish in the Muscle Up Clean Ladder. He can't have more of those finishes today if he wants to hold on to the podium.
No, he's got to change this yo-yo performance around on the last day and just be consistent through the end if he wants to get one of those podium spots finish higher than he did last year.
And we saw an exciting race between him and Matt Fraser to close out Strongman's Fear, but some smart movement by Brett Fikowski to get his foot across the line. And even though he got capped here, I think it's important to note that he seemed pretty composed, didn't seem too worried about it. You know what? Get it out of your mind and on to the next one.
Yeah, you got to just move forward from those things that don't slide your way.
And overall, after 10 events going into the final day, Matt Fraser has a 174-point lead over second place Noah Olsen. Last year at this point, Matt Fraser had a 160-point lead, so he's breaking new ground in terms of historic performances here at the CrossFit Games. Brent Fikowski, Ricky Garrard, and Scott Panchik hanging tough there in the fifth-place position, still within earshot of the possible top three position that he's been coveting for so long, but still an exciting performance from the men so far after 3 days. And here's what's on tap coming up this morning for the individuals in event number 11. We're calling that the Madison Triplet, five rounds of run 450 meters, then come back and do 11 hay bale clean burpees. They're using a 100-pound sandbag for the men, a 70-pound sandbag for the women. You'll notice that sandbag is colored yellow. We're calling that the cheese curd. They're basically gonna have to pick it up, load it over the hay bale, then do a burpee and jump over the hay bale to get back to the ball. The time cap is 20 minutes. We see the cheese curds out there. Hang tight. If you haven't had enough cheese curds already, we're gonna bring some more to you this morning. It's gonna be an exciting event to watch. Guys, thinking about this workout in particular, we'll start with you, Dan, and the men. Who are you looking forward to seeing in this event?
Honestly, I like Fikowski. Last year in the climbing snail, he did an incredible job with separating himself from the field there. There's a lot of similar aspects to that. There's a long run. That med ball is actually fairly light for the guys. I've heard a lot of people say that, man, I wish it was a little bit heavier. And usually that means I wish I could take a little more rest. Yeah. You know what I mean? You're not going to have the opportunity to take the rest here. You're going to have to keep pushing, moving that cheese curd over the hay bales, and then in terms of the burpees, it's just suck it up and go. I love the fact that it's hay bales too out there on the floor. We could have put a wall or boxes or something simple, but now we're going to scratch up your legs a little bit. We're going to make it uncomfortable, but Fikowski's my pick for this one.
Yep. That will be uncomfortable.
Yeah, and Brooke, who's your pick for the women?
Well, for the win, and I'm watching Sam Briggs. Here's my reasons why. It's not heavy, okay? And we moved the sandbag the other day. Mm-hmm. It's just awkward. Other than that, just that hip opening and hip movement, building up all of that fatigue in your legs and your midline, who's gonna be able to clear the fatigue on a run better than Sam Briggs? Nobody.
Yep, she's one of the best in the business when it comes to running. It's gonna be exciting to see her just manhandle that sandbag, and I have no doubt that she's gonna have no problem jumping over the hay bale. Here's the competition schedule for you guys on the final day of the CrossFit Games. 9 a.m., the Madison Triplet for the individuals kicks off. The teenagers, it's not announced yet, but they'll be having an event in the age group pavilion, so if you're curious about that, go check that out. 10:30 a.m., Masters 50 Plus will also have a workout that's yet to be announced in the age group pavilion. Then at 11, the teams kick off with the burpee litter relay. We're bringing the litter back from last year. That takes place in the North Park. Masters 35 Plus at 12:30 will be going in the age group pavilion as well. And here's what we got going for the Sunday fan experience. We've got presentations from Trifecta, CrossFit weightlifting training and rowing, and then a live podcast at 1 p.m. from Julie Fouché to close out the fan experience for today. And as always, another aspect of fan experience is social media here at the venue. Brooke, we've been checking out social media all weekend long. What stood out to you?
Honestly, there are so many handstand photos coming in, and we're actually picking five winners today. So we have when in Madison, Madison handstand, CrossFit Games, all the hashtags. That is a beautiful capital, by the way. Have you seen the capital?
Yeah, and a beautiful handstand as well.
Here in Africa, looks like she's picking that little guy up.
Love the force perspective.
And if you watched regionals, I liked the force perspective as well. Handstand in the Grand Canyon, that is close to my home.
You gotta be comfortable with your
Utah.
Handstand.
Yeah, that looks a little dangerous
yeah,
there.
It's a little scary. And of course, doing a handstand next to the Rocky statue, that rings true for a lot of people right now. People need to have that heart and power and strength going into the final day.
Yo, Adrian.
Yo, Adrian.
Some good handstand picks. You guys, thanks for keeping those coming. Keep them coming throughout the rest of the weekend as well. Here's how you guys at home can keep watching and stay up to date with everything CrossFit Games related. On TV, we have CBS coverage, and coverage from the CBS Sports Network. Our two-hour recap airs each night to close out the competition. Then online, you can watch the individual teams, masters, and team competitions live at the Games website. That's games.crossfit.com or on facebook.com/thecrossfitgames. That's the CrossFit Games Facebook page. That's going to do it for us right now. We're going to get you guys out to competition in individual event 11, the Madison Triplet.
We need a tracker of how many times somebody says cheese curd. Commercial made me think, what would happen? I thought you were just... Days down, one final day remains, and your eyes do not deceive you. Those are haystacks on the field at the North Park of the Alliant Energy Center as we start with women's event number 11. Brandon Domain, Chase Ingram, and Amanda Krenz. We got a new home this year in Madison, Wisconsin, and here in event 11 to start the final day, we pay homage to this area.
Yeah, we got sandbags. You're going to paint them yellow, a little cheese wheel out there. When you're talking these heavy sandbags, you have five rounds. We're mixing a run with seven hay bale clean burpees. They're gonna have to clean it, throw it over the hay bale, do a burpee, and then do that seven times. This is gonna be a very gritty workout to start the final day at the CrossFit Games.
Now I'm short, I'm looking at those haystacks that are 50 inches tall. There's gonna be some short athletes on the field as well. For more on them, we go to Amanda Krenz.
I talked to Kelly Jackson. She is a shorter athlete. She's on the demo team. That's made up of a few athletes who have the honor of coming out and testing these events. When she tested this, she had some trouble with those hay bales, again, because she's a shorter athlete. So some of the gals to keep an eye on in this heat, Alethea Boone, Madeline Sturt, Alexis Johnson, they are going to have to make up some time because they're going to have a little more trouble getting over those haystacks. So watch for them to pick up the pace when it comes to the burpees and the run.
Thank you, Amanda. And there's a field of 17 here in heat number one to start our last day of action at the 2017 Reebok CrossFit Games. Somebody I would want to keep an eye on, Games rookie Bethany Branham in lane number nine, but I know you've got your eye on a couple of our Games veterans here as they wind down their career.
And we're in the final day of competition, and we have some fan favorites saying a farewell after this season. Individually, Val Vobrel, who just turned 39 a couple days ago, this will be her final season as an individual competition. Stacey Tovar, after 8 years at the CrossFit Games, also saying goodbye after this weekend.
And away we go with a little run around the campus here at the Alliant Energy Center. You make that right turn and go behind the spectator seating area. Jessica Griffith had the one of the early lanes, so it's going to be hard to judge where they are in terms of placing during this opening run, especially because everybody's going to be scattered based on where they were at the start.
And you'll probably see them bunch up once we get onto the middle of the course. So what they have to do is they get onto the floor, is they have to run back to their nameplate before they can start working their way down the field. And as you start an event like this, when you have five runs over 400 meters and only seven reps once you get to the field, this now becomes more of a running event. So we're looking at how to set this up is that traditionally with events that involve some running for multiple rounds, you become a little bit more complacent on the run, knowing you need to put more work on the field. You need to race once you get onto the competition floor because there is only seven reps. Now, those seven reps aren't short reps by any means, but the run is much more important than you would normally think in traditional style workouts.
Lauren Fisher leading the way around the turn as they make their way back towards the stadium, but Turi Helgadottir is second in line. She was in lane number 11. She's gone around 10 athletes since the start of this run. So he said it's hard to tell where they are placing-wise. Turi Helgadottir's on a tear here on this opening run, though.
What we're just talking about is that you have to make the run a priority every single round because there's not enough repetitions on the field to make up for a slow run time. So some of these athletes, you don't want to come out of the gates too hot, but you can't be complacent on the run. As they're working into their first rounds, you can see here's the biggest issue is that you need a pace to run, but that doesn't mean slow. You have to run at a strong pace. And then the race is on the hay bales. And what it is about being fast and speedy. And we talked about the height at the very start of this. Look how wide that is. Some of the issues with these sandbags is that it's harder to just throw it over. See how it stopped right there on the top for Alexis Johnson? You have to have not only a good clean, but a hard throw to just get it over the width of these hay bales.
As they wrap up round number one, a set of seven hay bale clean burpees with that 70-pound sandbag. Turi Helgadottir continuing to lead the way. She was the first one around her chest piece in lane number 11 and continues to lead as she has one rep remaining. Now you'll notice that sandbag is going to wind up on the opposite side of the hay bale from where they're going to exit the field. You still have to hop over all of these hay bales as you make your way through later rounds.
See Turi Helgadottir climbing over the first stack and back onto her second round on the run. So I like the aggressive pace set early by Turi Helgadottir.
So Turi Helgadottir leading the way. Margot Alvarez in second as we start our second run. Helgadottir's opening round time, 2 minutes, 53 seconds. She's opened up a solid lead over Margot Alvarez in second, and there is a large pack right behind her in that race for third.
And this is something that if you're in the second heat, you really need to analyze and understand is that this isn't a traditional event where the run is the, I would say, quote, rest time, or the time where you can kind of gather yourself and pace this out. You do want to pace the run, but it's a race pace. It's 450 meters, which is long. For five rounds, that's over, well over a mile, nearly a mile and a half of total running for this event. But when you only have those seven reps on the backside, you're gonna spend more time on the run than you are on the hay bale.
This is a troubling sign from Anna Tobias, who really you could consider her one of the favorites in an event with so much running, but she seems to be in a little bit of distress.
She is, but if you've kind of watched her career over the games over the last few years, is that she's always had kind of Achilles calf issues every single year, and some of that can be very chronic and not go away very easily. She's been limping around all weekend.
Turi Helgadottir making her way back into the end zone and around her chest piece. She'll have to go over the wall as the rest of the field trying to catch her, but it is a significant lead for the young Icelandic athlete. She's already through her first hay bale clean. There's the burpee and there's the hop over the wall.
And there's one thing that needs to really be noted is that it's the timing and tempo of everything. Are you going to misstep on your first clean? Are you going to not be able to get it all the way across the width of that hay bale? Are you going to pause a second or two in between every rep? Are you going to forget that you have to do a burpee after the clean and not before? Those type of mistakes can be very costly. I love the aggressive pace by Turi and how consistent she is every single rep.
There's something else to be considered with using hay in an event. It's allergies. For more on that, we go to Amanda Krenz.
If you're from the Midwest, like a lot of people here are, hay allergies are not anything unusual. A lot of the athletes in this heat may not be familiar with them, though, until after this event is over. Kelly Jackson on the demo team, again, an athlete I talked to earlier, did have a slight reaction after she tested this event. Nothing serious. The medical personnel are ready to treat anything like that. But you do see a couple athletes wearing tights. I saw one with long sleeves, so they might have come in prepared.
Thank you, Amanda. And Turi Helgadottir prepared to lead the way since the very beginning of this one. She came out, shot like a cannon on that opening run, and she has a significant lead, 17 seconds quicker than Bethany Branham in second.
But Branham is closing the distance. If you're looking at the entire time done per the round, Turi Helgadottir's runs are right around that 2 to 210 range. So is Bethany Branham, as they are sitting 1-2 currently in the heat. So Turi is pushing the pace, and like I said before, this is an aggressive pace that you need. I know it's a longer event, but with the style of movements you have, it's just a couplet, really. I mean, you have the burpee in there as well as the clean, so that is your three movements. But when you want to look at it, it's like you've got the run and then you have what you do on the field. You need to maximize both ends. There's not enough movements in here that you can kind of take a break on one then versus the other two.
The left box on the screen is our runners that are trying to chase down Turi Helgadottir. On the right box was everybody still working on that second round of seven hay bale clean burpees. But Turi Helgadottir, we got to zoom out a long way to find Bethany Branham in second.
We also have a very long way to go. This is just the third or midpoint of the third round, so we're just about halfway through, and what Branham is doing well is that she's not backing off the pace. She is behind her by a significant margin on the course, but when you think about how long it takes to make up that time, she's only about 10 to 15 seconds behind Turi Helgadottir.
Through the first 10 events of the weekend, every single event winner on the women's side is currently in a top 10 points position. But here in heat number one, with the pace that Helgadottir and also Branham is setting, it's possible that we could have somebody from heat number one play a significant spoiler role in a points race where Tia Claire Toomey is only 14 points clear of her nearest competitor, Carl Webb.
Well, they need a lot of athletes in it. By they, I mean, if you're talking about who else is on the leaderboard on the outside looking in, Katrin Davisdottir is over 100 points out of first place. So she needs a lot of athletes to step up to the plate, especially in this first heat, if she wants to make big chunks of points made up on the leaderboard. As Turi's getting into her first set, I know it seemed like Bethany Branham was well behind. She was only 10 seconds behind Turi on the course. So, like I said, is that running distances are very deceiving when she's only one or two reps behind her once you get to a much slower movement with these clean over the hay bales.
As you'll notice, Turi Helgadottir's name highlighted in blue as the leader. It's one rep for every run that is completed, and we're also counting one rep for every time. Both the sandbag, or cheese curd, if you will, and the athlete make their way over their hay bale. Valerie Boberol, one of the athletes that are trying to chase down our leader.
And I wanted to make sure is that before we get duped again by the end of an event that we say her name before she crosses the finish line and we didn't see her coming. Val is just sneakily sitting in third in this heat.
Problem for Val is I think whenever we bring it up is when it doesn't happen for her. Whenever you just don't notice her, it's almost like the door to Narnia. If you're looking for it, you're not going to get there. But Valerie Boberol trying to close in. She's three reps behind Turi Helgadottir, who's making her way back down those walls. So she's gonna hop over more and more hay bales every single round. So we're just past the halfway point in terms of the time cap, 10 and a half minutes in on this 20 minute time limit event to start day number four. Turi Helgadottir's already through 3 of 5 rounds.
Sticking with that aggressive pace, and you know, that's really hard to do. It's easy to start fast, maybe even to a second round, but sometimes you'll see athletes get complacent as they get well ahead of the rest of the field, but Turi is not pulling back whatsoever, and that's a very difficult thing to do when you're this far ahead of just the second place individual.
Leader in the box on the left side of the screen. On the right, Whitney Yelin and Jessica Griffith making their way back onto the track for another 450-meter run in round number four. Turi Helgadottir is already more than 200 meters into that run.
I know she's very focused on the job that and the task that she has at hand, but when she's taking the turns, you'll see her look over her shoulder, so staying very aware of who's behind her. A lot of those athletes, and you know, what a good athlete does is they not only know their own craft, but they know the crafts of the other individuals in their heat. You know, you can look over the shoulder and see someone that you know doesn't like running, and that almost kind of fuels your pace just a little bit more.
Turi Helgadottir kind of looks like a dot near the top of the screen, making her way towards that turn. You saw the distance interval between her and second place Bethany Branham. It's about 80 to 100 meters, the gap. And there is Branham. It's just a large distance as she finally appears from behind that tree. And Turi Helgadottir is in cruise control with one heat remaining. She still needs to push the tempo, and she's still doing just that as she makes her way back to the field for the fourth time.
And so there's two different styles in this event, the pace on your run and your pace here on the hay bales. The time difference between the two is about minutes. It's about half the time on the hay bales than it takes more of these athletes traditionally to do on the run. That being said, is that when you have two athletes like Turi and Bethany, is that one has to kind of make up ground in other areas. Turi's pace on the run is so fast that Bethany Branham is going to have to start taking more chances when you get to the hay bales. Turi wasn't able to toss that sandbag as well the first time, but watch Turi go over the hay bales. Jump, puts a foot up, kind of does that belly slide where Branham is doing more of a roll. If Branham can be a bit more aggressive into that rollover, she can make up a second here and a second there. And we're talking about, you know, Turi's only about 15 to 20 seconds ahead of her. We still have 20 plus reps left of these where you can make up seconds through the rest of the round. So Bethany Branham, I'd like to see her to be a bit more aggressive on that rollover and try to make up a second on Turi.
Helgadottir continuing to lead, really has since the start when she had a minute 47 time on that opening 450-meter run. Branham in second, Val Voberl four reps behind the leader, Helgadottir. Jessica Coughlin and Margot Alvarez rounding out our top five. But Turi Helgadottir is moving on to round number five. She's going to have to hop over 450-inch tall haystacks before she starts her final 450-meter run.
There's the roll that she hasn't done the first three rounds, and I think some of that plays into, look at that, look how aggressive that is. That's what you want to see. You can't approach these hay barrels slow, especially if you're a shoulder athlete. You have to attack, roll, and use that momentum to get over. The climb and the foot over the top is just wasted time.
Last round for Turi Helgadottir was 3 minutes, 55 seconds, and she has a little over 5 minutes remaining until the 20-minute time cap. Bethany Branham about 15 seconds back, and Valerie Voberl closer to a minute back, a good 50 seconds. Problem for Branham is how much time she's been losing on the run. She hasn't been losing ground on those sandbag clean and burpees over the haystack, but she's losing about 15 seconds around on the run.
Yeah, the first run, they were very close. It was only separated by seconds. Branham was actually faster on the second 450-meter run, but once we got to the third and fourth round, you had a 5-second difference, pushing back to a 16-second difference on the runs alone, and that's too much time to try to make up on these cleans over the hay bales, which is why I said is that you pace the run, but it's still a strong pace. It's hard to make up room on the clean since it's only seven. Unfortunately for some of the athletes in the later heats, if you want to win this event, you're going to have to push the runs.
And Bethany Branham, if she's trying to find how far behind she is of Turi Helgadottir, she's going to have a hard time trying to find Turi. There she is, all the way at the top of the screen, making her way around that 180 degree turn. And for Turi Helgadottir, her best career event finish coming into this event is second place on Sprint Course 1 back in 2015. Into this year, she had 3 top 5 finishes, 8 top 10s, but she's gotten better and better by the year. 35th in her first appearance in 2012, 28th in 2015, 19th 1 year ago. As she enters today, 24th in the point standings. But if this holds up, and it could very well hold up as a top time, this is going to be a strong performance to move her back up the leaderboard.
And she's still opting for this, kind of that whatever it takes to get over. She'll jump, put a right knee on, get the left foot over. And part of the reason of that is that, yes, the roll might be faster, but that makes you very, very disoriented. And we're talking about cleans and burpees over the hay bales. The last thing you wanted, you're already breathing hard, everything hurts. You don't want to feel like you're going to throw up at the same time by rolling in circles over 5 hay bales.
2 reps down, 5 reps remain for Turi. Working towards rep number 40 on that tracker on the top of the screen. She's got 2.5 minutes to get there. Bethany Branham is there, but 3 reps behind Turi Helgadottir, who's in position to go wire to wire with a Heat 1 win. Valerie Voberl in third place as she's gotten around Casey Campbell. But Turi Helgadottir passed 10 people on that opening 450-meter run and never looked back. Once she finished that run, she's been the leader all the way through. She picks up the sandbag, carries it across the line. It's a Heat 1 win for Turi Helgadottir. That's going to be a tough time for anybody in heat number 2 to catch. 18 minutes, 8.67 seconds. Bethany Branham putting in a solid performance as well.
And this event, an event like this, is more her speed with that endurance background. It's not a heavy sandbag for her, so she capitalized on an event that was more in her wheelhouse.
She'll cross the line, 18 minutes, 37.32 seconds, about a half minute behind Helgadottir. Valerie Voberl trying to hold off Margot Alvarez for the third position. She has a 1 rep advantage. Final rep for Valerie Voberl. And up and over the wall. The woman that celebrated her 39th birthday on Friday will celebrate a third place finish here in heat number 1. 1 minute behind Turi Helgadottir and Margot Alvarez right behind her at 19:13. Jessica Coughlin will round out the top 5 as we have about 30 seconds remaining until the 20 minute time cap. Whitney Yalin will be our next finisher. She's in the center of the screen, crossing the line, dropping that sandbag. Kirsten Pedry was right behind her to take 7th place. And it took 18 minutes to get 1 finisher, and now we're having them go at a rapid rate. Final 5 seconds. Jessica Griffith will finish. Stacey Tovar will be close in blue and those long black tights, but unable to beat the time cap, and we will have 8 athletes able to do so, led by Turi Helgadottir at 18 minutes, 8.67 seconds.
One thing that's not easy is to start at an aggressive pace when you have 5 rounds of running and then these 7 cleans over the hay bales every single round. But the pace at which Turi held right off the bat, she was in the back half, but she wasn't in the lead, she was in one of the furthest lanes. She passed everybody on the first one. She had a nice, consistent pace every single round. She stayed aggressive. She wasn't really going terribly fast, but there was no hesitation and no pausing. And the B through 5 total rounds, she pushed the runs. So if you're sitting in the second heat, you need to observe that, analyze that, and understand is that as much as these hay barrels are a hindrance, an annoyance, is that it's gonna come down to how fast you're willing to go on the runs. For these cleans, just staying close to your bag, consistent, a good rollover in between the reps. Start to finish, Turi Helgadot.
One heat down, one heat remains for a full field of 20 as we start our last day of the 2017 Reebok CrossFit Games with women's event number 11. And after the first 10 events, it's good to be Australian. Tia Claire Toomey in first place at 786, 14 points ahead of fellow countrywoman Cara Webb in second, Sarah Sigmund's daughter, Annie Thoris' daughter, and Tennille Reed-Burline rounding out our top five.
And I think we start off with an event that a lot of different things can happen. You have a longer run and some hay bale clean burpees, 70 pounds with these sandbags. You have to throw it over the hay bale, not just the height, but the width. And then the speed with reps. You're gonna have to push the run for this event.
The height will be a factor as it's 50 inches tall on those hay bales. For more there, we go to Amanda Krenz.
I talked to Kelly Jackson, one of the members of the demo team who get to test these events. She is a shorter athlete and she had trouble with these hay bales. She said basically she was having to do a bar muscle up every time to get over one of those hay bales as she watched a taller athlete sort of cruise by next to her. So her strategy became at that point then to pick up some time on the burpees and on that run.
Thank you, Amanda, here in heat number two. Like I mentioned, it's a full field of 20 athletes. And most notably on here, your points leader is in lane number 10, Tia Claire Toomey, facing the pressure of trying to be second no more, the two-time defending runner-up.
Well, when you talk to Tia Claire Toomey, this isn't the first time she's come into the final day with a small points edge over the rest of the field. And I think some of that pressure, you know, we said her biggest weakness last year was just not believing in herself. Not having a confidence in herself, even when you're in the lead. I think sometimes when you have athletes that all they're worried about is losing something, then that's exactly what's really gonna happen. You are going to lose. What I'd like to see from Tia Claire is that, yes, you have a small points lead on Cara Webb, who's sitting in second, but that rest of the field is not going to back off. It was different last year on Sunday. We had three 100 points events to start the day last year. Catherine Davis' daughter was behind, but she had room and a lot of events to catch up. She's over 100 points out. You said you need people in heat one to affect heat two. She's gonna need not just event wins, but she's gonna need a lot of help if she wants to repeat for the third time.
And she needs to help herself as well, and she's got her first shot here on the last day of the 2017 Reebok CrossFit Games as we're underway with heat two of two. No surprise, who's leading the way on the run, and it's Samantha Briggs.
Briggs is one of those athletes who is still sitting inside the top 10, ninth place overall, but her role this weekend is going to try to push the pace of the run and then play one of those filler athletes to try to squeeze in between Tia and the other athletes on the leaderboard.
Sam Briggs went by five people right out of the gate, and when it comes to your first key, there might be nobody better in this field than Sam.
And I almost want to turn that P of pace into an R, because you got to pace the run, but that pace is a race pace. And then when you get back to the field, you're gonna have to push it there too. It's a long event, but since it's broke up so differently between a long run and a short, I would say, sprint here on the field, you're gonna have to race both of them if you want to win this event.
Briggs in that bright yellow tank top leading the way. Kristen Holta, also known for her endurance background, in second place in the points leader. As indicated by that white points leader jersey, Tia Claire Toomey will be third. But remember, the placings will be a little bit different. It depends on what lane they started in.
And as we start to think about how the weekend's gonna unfold, you got Sam Briggs ahead, Aramo as well, but what we don't really understand is that, yes, they were in a tight group, but Tia Claire was not that far behind, because Briggs had a lead at the start based off where their nameplates are on the field. Look at the left side of your screen. They have to run to that space at the start and the finish of every one. So Tia Claire, though she was in about fifth in the group, she was right behind your top leaders on the first run.
Leader's name will be highlighted in blue. That currently to Neil Reed Berline. Everybody else will be in red. If you see a minus number, that's how many reps they are behind the lead, as we have Sam Briggs on the left, Kristen Holta on the right, a couple of Meridian Regional athletes.
These are two athletes that are going to do very well or have the ability to do very well in this event. Now, if you're talking about Captain David's daughter, who is so far out of the points contention for first and a third-time repeat, she needs these girls to do well, but she also has to beat them at the same time. She needs to put as many people between her and Tia Claire Toomey as possible.
David's daughter in the green and blue. She's currently in the third position in the heat, make it second. But we've got plenty of athletes all right within a couple of seconds of each other. And yes, they do have to go over those 50-inch hay bales. More and more throughout every round, they'll add one hop over that wall.
Look how tight it is at the very start of the second round. We did not see this, anything like this in the first heat. How Turi Helgadottir was so far ahead of everybody after just one round. Sam Briggs, though, she's leading in the front, and I'm not surprised to see her leading on a run, but look at right behind her. You see Halty, Aramo, good first round, and then here comes Tennille Reed Berline. She had a great day yesterday, found herself in the leader jersey for one event, did not have to finish of Saturday night like she wanted to, but she's not out of contention at this point in time.
And she was the points leader going into event number 9. Coming out of event number 10, she is in fifth. But 80 points separate Tia Claire Toomey in first, to Reed in fifth. Annie Thorisdottir trying to get back onto the podium for yet another time in a career resurgence here for her. She is in fourth, Sigmundsdottir in third, just 6 points ahead of Annie for that final podium spot.
He is behind your early leaders. You have those three athletes in front, but as I said before, it kind of depends where their nameplates come onto the field. She looked like she was pretty far behind after the first run. But with Tia, she only has a slim edge over second place. I know we're talking about Katrin. Katrin's well out at over 100 points, but if Tia doesn't want a second place finish for the third year in a row, she needs to make sure she's well ahead of Cara Webb, who's been breathing down her neck.
Second time back to the stadium for Sam Briggs, and we were talking about the distance between these lanes. Briggs is making it where it doesn't even matter with how far she is ahead. And she's already over one wall, gets to the sandbag, and nobody else has joined her just yet as she's through one rep. It's a one rep lead for Sam Briggs over Kristen Holta at the top of the screen. That'd be Christy Aramo in the lighter blue tank top on the near side a moment ago.
Now in the first run, we didn't mention one name very much because we're so focused on Brits, Aramo, Holte, and Toomey. And then all of a sudden, off to the second run, we said the name Tennille Reed Berline, who's sitting in that fifth overall place position. She had the fastest split, second to Katrin David's daughter, by almost 10 seconds on the rest of the field. So you need to push the run and also push the pace here. You don't want one to overpower the other. And so I really like to see this being, I would say this is more of a strength on Tennille's side, is this kind of grunt work, odd object, more of an athletic style, because you do have that roll over the top that you need. So Tennille Reed, I'd rather almost try to make up 10 seconds here than 10 whole seconds on a 450-meter run. That's a lot more energy it takes to make up time on the run than it does here on the cleans.
Briggs is through her final rep in round number 2, as is Toomey, Holta, and Tennille Reed Berline, all making their way back over those haystacks, and Briggs and Holta will be 1-2 as they head back to the track for round number 3. This is still quicker than the event leading pace of Turi Helgadottir, who was through round number 2 at 6 minutes and 34 seconds.
With 706 points.
Pretty solid interval, almost equal distance from first to second, second to third, third to fourth. As it's Briggs one, Holta two, Toomey in third, and then Tennille Reed-Burline in fourth.
And if you think about, we had an event kind of as a start Sunday. We always tend to have kind of like a run odd object event. A couple years ago, we had the Midline Madness where it was the berm runs at the soccer stadium in Carson, California with the yoke sprints. So we saw that iconic image of Sam Briggs running past the previous game's champ, Camille Leblanc-Bazinet, and patting her on the back as she laps her. As I just watched Danny Horan leave the field to finish her second round, Sam Briggs has almost run in. We might see that same thing happen again with Briggs.
Just a sign of how impressive the motor of Sam Briggs is, as she's known at this point for lapping other games' athletes. We're not talking about everyday athletes. These are 40 of the fittest women in the world. And they're in danger of being lapped by that woman. Sam Briggs is cruising through this as she gets back to the field for the third time.
The sign of an athlete who has nearly perfected their skill is one that makes things look so easy and effortless. The pace at which she is running and moving through these sandbags. You know, I think Bill Murray had the best tweet of the Olympics a couple years ago. He says, I think we need to designate a lane for your average everyday CrossFitter to just show you how good these athletes are. Sam Briggs is making 39 of the fittest other women in the world look like just average human beings. I mean, these are the best of the best, and you have someone that makes them look slow. It's incredible.
Carl Webb had a bit of a struggle getting over that first wall. She about knocked herself over. She's the second place in the point standings coming into this event in the dark blue tank top and the light blue pants, making her way to the third wall as Sarah Sigmund's daughter, third in the point standings. So we might have a big shakeup, and the big winner here could be Tia Claire Toomey.
When you start to look at point differentials, you see that Tennille's in fifth place, 26 points out of that third place position that Sarah's holding on to. Kara, though, she has a pretty big lead ahead of that third place position, as she was only 14 behind Toomey. But let's look at how this point system works. From first to 10, 10 places, that's all it takes. You can lose 40 points on the leaderboard. So a lot of things are still up in the air as we start Sunday.
Round four underway. 30 seconds quicker than the pace of the event leader, Turi Helgadottir, who is in at 18.08. That time likely isn't going to hold for too much longer. To add to your point, Chase, about the point scoring system, it's a 6-point differential for every place in the top three, 194.88. From there down to 11th, a 4-point differential. And then from there on down, 2 points separating every position from 11th to 40th, which would be a 0-point performance. The right box on the screen, Katrin Davidsdottir in the blue shorts, Kara Webb in the green pants. Also a factor in this points race, both in the top six. Webb, the closest rival to Toomey, but while Toomey is currently holding a solid position in this one, as she runs by on the left box, Kara Webb is losing a lot of ground, not just in this heat, not just in this event, but in the point standings as well.
And as Sam Briggs, who said she was in ninth, kind of out of contention to play spoiler alert. I mean, 100 points goes a long way when you're thinking about the second, third through sixth athletes not capitalizing on their leaderboard positioning.
And this pack, I could almost call it the peloton with how clumped together they are here. Three of the top six athletes in the point standings. You saw Annie Thorisdottir, Kara Webb, and Katrin Davidsdottir all lumped into that group.
Well, there was a time we thought Kara Webb has fallen way behind the total field, but her runs have been actually very consistent. Katrin Davidsdottir, who was pushing the pace early, lost about 20 seconds of her pace from round two to round three on that third 450-meter run.
Tia Claire Toomey sitting in third, one spot ahead of Tennille Reed-Burline, as it's Briggs one, Holta two, Toomey three. Sam Briggs had a moment to say some words of encouragement to Cassidy Lance McWhorter as she went off the field to start round number four. Briggs is back on the field to close out round number four.
What I've really liked to see as Briggs is moving, just this is a normal start of Sunday for Sam Briggs. Just an unbelievable pace that she can set and maintain. It's just one of these athletes who just lives in that pain cave and just kind of kicks her feet up, puts her hands behind her head, and is wondering where everybody else is in this place. But what I like to see on the right box is Toomey, who's sitting in the leader's jersey, is not backing down. The other side of that is that I like that she's not trying to chase too hard. You gotta know the athletes that you're racing on the leaderboard. This is why I like athletes who look around during the competition instead of just stay within their own race. The race is going on around you, not in your own head. It's happening to your left and to your right. She does not need to overexert herself to try to catch Holte or Briggs. She just needs to make sure that she's well ahead of Webb, Tennille, and Thorisdottir, who are the only ones that are really within striking distance of that first place position for her.
Coming back to the field for round number four of the Hay Bale Clean Burpees, Tia Claire Toomey, third in the heat. Carl Webb, eighth. Annie Thorisdottir, ninth. Katrin Davidsdottir, 12th. Sarah Sigmundsdottir, 13th. But Sam Briggs starting round number five. And she's made this look easy. Nearly 1 minute quicker than the pace of Turi Helgadottir, who has the top time of 1808.67. And Sam Briggs could basically walk at this point and still beat that time. Right side of the screen, Tia Claire Toomey. She's in striking distance of catching Kristen Holte. Holte just now starting her run. Toomey one hay bale jump away from starting hers. So it continues to be Briggs one, Holte two, Toomey three. About a 20-second advantage for Sam Briggs over Kristen Holte and a battle of two of the best endurance athletes in the women's field at the 2017 Reebok CrossFit Games. Tia Claire Toomey holding tight in third. And more importantly for her is that Carl Webb, who is 14 points behind her entering this event, is just now starting round number five.
But there's not a lot of people between her and Tia Claire Toomey. That's kind of the difference, is that you can beat someone by an entire lap, but if there's no one in between, that's the most important part when you're looking at the athletes on the field. Tennille Reed at the top part as she's making the turn, Tia Toomey at the bottom. There's only two people in between Cara Webb and Tia Claire at this moment. Now you gotta look at the times from the previous heat at the same time. But Jamie Green is the only one that's in between, along with Tennille Reed.
Webb is third in this line. Ahead of her is Jamie Green in yellow, and Caroline Reason-Tebow in gray. Webb has them in her sights. Those could be two huge positions for Carl Webb with point implications, but Sam Briggs has 2.5 minutes to finish this fifth and final round of seven reps. Samantha Briggs, the third ever individual athlete in the open division to reach double-digit career event wins. It's Rich Froning at 16, Annie Thorisdottir at 13. For about another minute, Sam Briggs is at 10. Tia Claire Toomey continuing to have that stranglehold on the points lead, but just barely. She sits in third coming back to the field behind both Briggs and Holte.
The only other athlete, or we'll say competitor, that she needs to worry about is the clock and the best time that's already happened today. With Turi Helgadottir's time of 18:08, it's just another body that kind of gets in the way, but as long as she stays ahead of the people that are chasing her, aside from the eighth and ninth place athletes on the leaderboard, she's doing a fantastic job to start the fourth day.
This will be a good win for Toomey as you see Kara Webb making her way back into the field as well. But Sam Briggs has one rep remaining after she hops over this hay bale. It will be the third most all-time career win number 11 for Sam Briggs. And sound the siren, because engine number 13 is kicking off day number 4 with a win. Still 40 seconds till the time to beat. Put Kristen Holta in second place. This is big for Tia Claire Toomey. If she can beat that 18.08 time of Turi Helgenotter, she'll be good for third in the event.
Well, Webb, you know, she's chasing Tia Claire Toomey, but she's also trying to hold on to a podium spot at which she's never gotten before. When she left, she only had Thibault and Tennille ahead of her alongside Jamie Green. There are six other athletes that matched up with her at the end of that last run.
Points leader into event 11, points leader out of event 11 for Tia Claire Toomey, Tennille Reed-Burline. We'll have a nice recovery after a couple of struggles to close out day number 3. She'll be fourth in the heat and still good for fourth in the event, as Turi Helgedotter's time has just now passed to round out the top 5. Jamie Green will close out the top 5 in the heat at 18:17. Race to the line. Kara Webb is going to pass a couple of athletes late. She'll be good for sixth in the heat. We'll make it eighth in the heat as China Cho is in there just ahead. So eighth in the heat, ninth in the event at 18:27.16. And we talk about fractions of a second playing a difference. 0.02 for Kara Webb over Christy Aramo. Annie Thoris' daughter will be just behind Katrin David's daughter, who finishes 12th. Thoris' daughter in 13th. And Katrin just showing the signs after this one. But this is huge. Sarah Sigmund's daughter, still with 2 reps remaining.
Sarah is holding on to that third place position coming into this morning. And we had a lot of athletes that were just behind her, finished well ahead of her in this heat.
And Sarah Sigmund's daughter, 17th in the heat, 22nd in the event. She'll lose 7 positions in this event to Annie Thorisdotter, and the gap going into this one for that race for third in the point standings was just 6 points. And there could not be much more that could go right for that woman, Tia Claire Toomey, who takes third place here in this event. But every one of her point rivals were well behind her, aside from Tennille Reed.
I said, as I know, Briggs and Holta went out to a very blistering pace, and Toomey did everything she needed to do. Stay ahead of the people behind her. You can almost let the other two go. You have such a good point spread. Just make sure you beat the people you need to beat to keep yourself one step ahead of the competition.
That white leader's jersey will stay on the body of Tia Claire Toomey. But no surprise here, as your event winner is Samantha Briggs. She takes event number 11 for her career event win number 11.
We're thinking about how to be successful in this event, not just successful, but how to win it. You gotta be willing to hurt. And I like what she did there. I don't know if you're gonna see that, is that she used the lowest points. Look at the hay bales. They kind of have this curve in the hay bale. She found the only lowest point. It was almost nearly like a channel to help make that throw over the hay bales just a little bit easier. She was aggressive the entire time, was always on the attack. I said that's one of the hardest things to do as an athlete, to be ahead of the field by yourself. She did have Holta breathing down her neck, but Tia Claire Toomey hung in there the entire time, trying to chase down two of the best, I would say, endurance athletes in the sport behind Briggs and Holta. But Briggs never let off the gas, got herself yet another event win this weekend and overall.
So Sam Briggs, 17:19.26, nearly a minute faster than the prior time to beat, which will still stand for Turi Helgedotter in fifth. Kristen Holta, Tia Claire Toomey, Tennille Reed-Burline, and then Helgedotter rounding out the top 5. And we can take a look at the point standings after 11 events, and Tia Claire Toomey's lead increases by 24 points, up to 38 now over Kara Webb. Tennille Reed-Burline, America's last hope for a podium finish here on the women's side. She's on that provisional podium, 14 points ahead of Annie Thorisdottir, and only 22 points ahead of Sarah Sigmund's daughter, as three Icelandic daughters are in fourth, fifth, and sixth, still in contention for that third spot. But your points leader, Tia Claire Toomey, is with Amanda Krenz.
Tia, another great event in the books for you. What kind of experience do you have with an obstacle like this, these haystacks?
Not a lot. I did grow up on a farm, but we didn't really have money hay bales, but it was so much fun, and the crowd is just incredible.
They're a big help, definitely. I am betting that you are not going to want to finish anything other than on the top of that podium after this competition is over with. So what are you going to focus on now for the rest of the competition to secure a spot at the top?
Right now I'm going to go and recover and then wait for Dave to announce the last workout.
Good luck, Tia.
Thanks, guys.
Not much more could go right for Tia Claire Toomey to start the final day of competition. Her points lead goes from 14 to 38 over Kara Webb as we're through event number 11. Event number 11 is also coming up next for the men as they start their final day of competition, as Matt Fraser is looking to continue his path of destruction. Is coming up next. For the first 3 days out of four at the 2017 Reebok CrossFit Games, it has been the Matt Fraser Show, but there's still 1 day of action remaining, and it starts with men's event number 11. Brandon Domain, Chase Ingram, and Sam Farber with you here in Madison, Wisconsin. And yes, those are hay bales on the field.
Hay bales, and we're throwing in some heavy sandbags, a little bit lighter than they needed to use at the regional level, 100 pounds. With those sandbags, they have to clean them, throw them over the hay bale, and then burpee over back to the other side. 7 total reps, couple that with a 450 meter run times 5. This is going to be a long workout, but there's no time to let off the gas.
So that's the overview. Let's get a deeper look at this event with Sam Farber.
Well, guys, this is an event where size is going to play a role. Size certainly matters, not so much for any of these shorter athletes getting over roughly 4 feet of hay bales, but what happens as they go over. When taller athletes are grouped together, depending on how they try and get over the hay bales, maybe they're rolling over, they can contact another athlete. I was talking to Graham Holmberg, 6-time games competitor. He's on the demo team this year, and he recalled back in 2012 on the obstacle course, accidentally kicking Lucas Parker in the face. Not saying anything's going to happen intentionally here, but we could see some contact in this sport.
And the first group of athletes that we'll see if anybody does get kicked in the face or not will be here in heat number 1. And there's some good names in this one. Zach Carchetti, one of those Metcon monsters, might be somebody to keep an eye on in lane number 4. But Josh Bridges last night, we saw something we haven't seen all weekend long.
We had a Josh Bridges sighting, and that makes me very excited. I hope that he's... whatever that was ailing him earlier has cleared. I want to see another Josh Bridges furious finish.
And Josh Bridges basically went into a sprint once that horn sounded. So he got around a couple of athletes right out of the gate. So we start with a 450 meter run, and the leader will be hard to figure out as they're starting with where their lane was in position. So if you were in lane number 1 or 2, like Wesley Rethwill or Alex Smith, you'll have a little bit of an edge over the rest of the field.
Will, and it's just the first run, and I think guys are trying to feel out the run and feel out the athletes around them. Now on the women's side, as they kind of pace the run, I take it back. Unfortunately for these athletes, you have to race the run, and then you have to race when you get to these hay bales. If you want to win this event, at least finish inside the top 5, you do not have time to have a slow pace. Look how fast Rob Forte is coming out on this first 400 meter run. This is the pace you need to start with, and it's going to be really hard to hold on to, but that's why this event was designed the way it is. You're going to have to go a lot harder than you want to.
Rob Forte had the lead. He was out of lane number 5. Paul Castillo out of lane number 6 will actually be leading the way as they make their way around that sweeping 180-degree right turn and back into the stadium for their first round of 7 hay bale burpees. So Paul Castillo and Alex Smith, both games rookies, surrounding the 7-time games qualifier Forte. The rest of the field making their way in. And one of the first ones back to the stadium is Josh Bridges, and he's one of those last lanes, so he's going to be in a pretty much better position than it looks right now.
Yeah, he's only about 5 or 10 seconds behind your top 3 leaders coming in. And, you know, we're touching on how tall these are, and I don't see that being an issue for Josh Bridges in this event. It's not necessarily a big man or a short guy deficiency or advantage. It's just the beauty of this one is that it's just work. Are you willing to run harder than you want to? Are you willing to run harder than the athletes around you? And then can you stay aggressive on these cleans and burpees?
So we've got the feel of Madison. We've got some hay bales we're jumping over. We also got some cheese curds out there. For more on that 100-pound sandbag, we go to Sam Farber.
Well, typically when you see the judges out at the CrossFit Games, they're watching for technique, but this is an event where technique is situationally dependent. Starting to CrossFit Games general manager Justin Berg, and he was referencing the fact that there's hundreds of thousands of people all over the world who use CrossFit to just better themselves in their daily life. They're not trying to compete. And this is an event that kind of speaks to them. You're not necessarily looking for a particular kind of form. It's just getting the object over that hay bale. It's a way to show everyone who does CrossFit and puts it into their everyday life that these athletes are doing it here in this particular event.
Thank you, Sam. And the person that moved those cheese curds over the hay bale along with their own body over the hay bale, the best here in round number one, was Paul Castillo, continuing to lead the way as we start round two.
Well, these guys are off to a pretty quick pace in round number one. And as fast as they go, I like the steady pace that Paul is. He has a nice stride, looks very comfortable. And what you don't want to see is people kind of tense up in their shoulders on the runs, especially when you're coming into some sandbag cleans and hay bale burpees. But this is one of those athletes that did so well at the regional level in events that really were more those grinders. And that's what this event is. It's a long event, 15 minutes plus, with five long runs in between. And that's a hard thing to do, is maintain that intensity across this time domain.
Castillo with about a 30-foot advantage over Rob Forte in the dark blue shirt, holding the second place position. Two athletes with significant experience when it comes to endurance work.
And that's what you want to see is, you know, sometimes you get a workout that fits more within your wheelhouse, so to speak. And we've seen running already. It feels like 2 weeks ago when we started the CrossFit Games off with a mile and a half run, 500 meter swim, mile and a half run. That was on Thursday. We have another run that's over that mile and a half section within this five round.
Back to the field, Paul Castillo in first, Rob Forte in second. And they'll make the turn around the chess piece before anybody else makes their way back to the field. It'll be Holden Rethwill in second, James Newberry right there with them, too, in that battle for third. But Josh Bridges, you see him hopping over the wall on the top of the screen. He's got that number five spot going into round number two.
And he had a good pace. Newberry actually has the fastest split so far in that 450-meter run, right around 209. And there's a lot of different ways to tackle this, and it's the balance between the two. He said before is that you're going to have to race the runs and race the cleans. The tough part is that when you have to race the run, there's no time to have a break, right? You're going to just slowly start elevating your heart rate. You're going to start breathing harder. And that never really, you don't get a break. And that's, I think, what the clean and the hay bale jump. Burpees are hard enough as they are, just always never letting you take a break. But that hay bale jump, that is a tough thing to do because of the exertion that it puts on your body to get over the top.
Those haystacks are 50 inches tall. Elijah Muhammad, one of the tallest athletes in the field, he's got a recorded box jump of 60 inches. This might be a good event for him if it comes to a battle on these hay bale clean burpees. But he's going to have some work to do to try to catch our three leaders as making their way into round number three. It's Paul Castillo in first, Holden Rethwill making his move into second place, and Rob Forte rounding out the top three. So a nice race starting as we reach the midway round of five in this 20-minute time cap event. Rob Forte about taking out that pylon there on the way, trying to get every second he can, cutting these turns as tight as possible. But Forte picking up the pace on this third run. He was 3 seconds quicker in round number two on this run over Castillo. Rethwill out of the top three actually had the fastest run, but he's starting to lag behind a little bit compared to Castillo and Forte. So a side-by-side lead for Castillo and Forte, but they've had to hold off Holden Rethwill. And where Rethwill's really been making up some time is on these hay bale clean burpees. and in the transitions as well, as he was through that last round on that movement by just 55 seconds. And he'll be in the green tank top. And there's Wethrell on the bottom of the screen. That's impressive.
Oh, that makes up a lot of time. That saves you an incredible amount of time. It'd be kind of hard to do that when you're going from burpee to burpee, just because that's one of those type of movements that you'll need a running start. But if you're coming into these later rounds where you have to clear four sets of hay bales to get to that final round, that could be a very good trick to have in your back pocket if it's coming down to a race towards the end.
Rob Forte, a slight lead over Paul Castillo. Forte, a rookie all the way back in 2011. As Rethwill, once again with those hurdles over this 50-inch hay bale, making up ground on that transition, which could be important in the end. So it's a 2011 rookie, Rob Forte, making his seventh consecutive appearance in first, and two rookies in second and third, with Paul Castillo and Holden Rethwill. Jason Carroll also moving his name into the mix. And somebody that won't be able to hurdle that easily over the hay bales is Dakota Rager. His hay bales are 50 inches tall. Rager is only 5'4".
But I like the way he uses this roll. Watch him, he'll kind of do a burpee. He'll roll and tuck the arm underneath. That's more of like a jiu-jitsu rollout where you kind of roll one shoulder underneath you, and it makes the rollout a lot easier. So yes, is he one of the shoulder athletes in the field? Is he eye level with the hay bale? But positioning and technique actually plays a big role when it comes to just trying to be more efficient getting over the hay bales.
Paul Castillo out in front, but on the bottom of the screen, also going over those hurdles. New name in the mix, and it's Jason Carroll. He's going to have to make up a little bit of distance because he's a few lanes over. We'll have to see how that plays out. As Wesley Rethwill once again in lane number one, those quick transitions on the hurdles. And all of a sudden, we've got a five-person race for the lead. Castillo in first, Forte second, Jason Carroll with the blue headband in third, Holden Rethwill in the green tank top just ahead of, also in a green tank top, James Newberry.
As you get to the fourth round, that, I think, to me, is the hardest part of a five-round event, because you get your first three, you kind of get in your rhythm in round one, try to solidify that in two, and hold on in three. That fourth round is kind of that no-man's land round when they have the five. Anytime you're doing an event like this or inside your gym, is that fourth round tends to be the worst one. It's so hard to hang on to that pace, knowing full well you've already done three, still have one more to go. So if you want to try to push the pace and maybe make a move, it's the fourth round where I'd like to see some athletes take some chances that need to.
Paul Castillo continuing to lead the way out of Toledo, Ohio. And in the 6 weeks leading up to the games, he completed two sprint triathlons in that time period. Not sure if there were any hay bales involved in those sprint tries, but he's somebody that's put in a lot of work on the endurance field, and he enjoys doing those sprint triathlons and pushing the tempo like he has been.
And a lot of that is just being comfortable being uncomfortable. To be, you know, the intensity isn't high in terms of power output, but it is high in terms of your heart rate is jacked, you're breathing hard, and you feel like you got battery acid running through your veins. But it's never going to get necessarily any worse, and being able to be comfortable with that is a good advantage to have over the rest of the athletes.
New leader, though, getting to the chess pieces is Jason Carroll on the far right side of the screen. Over the last couple of rounds, his runs have just not dropped off that much. This latest one, 2:42, so Jason Carroll out in front by one rep, and his name highlighted in blue for the very first time as our heat leader.
And And that was a good run split for Jason Carroll, who's just slowly kind of creeping up on everybody. But what he's really been doing is that he's been extremely fast on these cleans over the hay barrels. That is where he's made most of his moves on the other athletes in this field. And what you can kind of do is that you want to race at a pace on the run that is right near your threshold, because there's not room to jog through this. But if you're comfortable enough to kind of power through these cleans, is that you can make up those 1 to 2 seconds per rep on the other guys.
Carroll through round number four will drop off that 100-pound sandbag. He'll have to hop over four hay bales before he starts the round. Paul Castillo 5 seconds behind him in green and blue near the bottom of the screen. But it's Jason Carroll already over two, now three of those hay bales. And as his name gets announced as a leader for the first time by the live MCs, he gives a little salute to the crowd on his way back out for his final round.
Once you get into that fifth round, I said the fourth round's the toughest to maintain a pace and to push a pace. What I like about Jason Carroll is that, you know, as you see him kind of wave around, is that to be that relaxed and calm in this type of setting, that's a tough athlete to run down. When he was so quick, he's so far, he still has the fastest split time on the cleans as anybody was in that fourth round. I want to see Carroll push the pace a little bit more. His advantage over Castillo is not just the distance between the two of them. When he gets onto the field, his finish mat or start mat is much closer to the left side of the field, as they'll be approaching that on the way in, than Paul Castillo's side. So not only does he have this distance advantage now, he's gonna add about 20 more feet to that just by stepping onto the floor.
In round number four, Carroll was 8 seconds faster than Castillo on the run, about 2.7 seconds quicker than Castillo on the hay bale portion of this event. For a good 10-second differential between the two, we'll see if he can keep that pace or if Paul Castillo can reel him back in. Third place, right behind Castillo, that would be James Newbury out of the Pacific Regional. He sits in third. His run times have been just as fast as Carroll's, but he's been slower on the seven rep portion.
Carroll's speed on the cleans has just been his efficiency between the reps. Everybody can be aggressive and powerful. It is only 100-pound sand. I say only 100-pound. It's come a long way to start saying things like that, but it's not as heavy as they've been used to. They had 150 at the regional level. And so there's a lot more confidence going into a weight like that than, say, a heavier sandbag.
He's got to hop over four of those hay bales before he gets to that 100-pound sandbag to start his work. But it's a significant lead for Jason Carroll, as Castillo is just now making his way over the first hay bale, as is Newbury. But Carroll already doing work. It'll be rep number 40 is the number you're looking for on the top of the screen. That will be the last one for Jason Carroll, who a year ago was one spot away from qualifying out of the California Regional.
Carroll's on the right side. Look at him looking over the bag. You see that landing position? Watch him. He's going to get a foot on top. He's not rolling. Foot on top, eye the bag. Watch him land right over the bag, picks it up. That is where he's making, I'm not going to say the joke because I was waiting for you to do it, making his hay in the event. But what he's doing is that he's cutting down. We're not talking about second. We're talking about multiple seconds per rep. So the roll, though it might be more fast over the top, there is a time delay how to get over the bag. You might see 20 other guys try to do this technique if they're able to watch in the background.
If technique moves the bar, efficiency moves the sandbag. Jason Carroll holding that sandbag up high and giving it a good old Gronk spike in the end zone as he leads the way 17:01.63, just ahead of Paul Castillo by 11 seconds. And he was only 2 seconds quicker than James Newbury to round out the top three here in heat one. Dakota Rager We said at the start of this, height might come into play, but it certainly didn't there for the 5'4 Rager. It's Michael Palumbo will round out the top five. You saw him blurring by the screen a moment ago at 17:31. Holden Rethwill will hold for sixth. Tim Paulson in seventh. Zach Carchetti was trying to leg out Josh Bridges, but he was unable to do so as Bridges will take eighth, Carchetti ninth, Forte. He was one of the leaders for the first four rounds, finds himself in 10th. ...2,250 meters of running, 35 hay bale clean burpees with a 100-pound sandbag, and we've got about 13 finishers all within a minute of the lead. Looking for our next finisher, it should be Travis Williams, shirtless with the purple headband. The center of the screen, and it will be Williams out of the South Regional, 13th place at 18 minutes, 37 seconds. Alex Smith, 18:47. We're still about a minute away from the 20-minute time cap. Jeff Patzer, Samuel Quant will have a foot race to the line. Give the edge to Patzer in the purple shirt on the top of the screen, just ahead of Quant in the neon yellow shirt. Tommy Venus in 17th, just behind them. And that leaves Zeke Grove as our last remaining athlete. One rep remaining, the sandbag is over. He's got to get his body over. Pick up that 100-pound sandbag, take it to the end zone, round out the field here in heat number one. 19 minutes and 39 seconds for Zeke Grove out of Australia. But Jason Carroll, 17:01, will have the heat win and the event time to beat.
Right from the start, Paul Castillo was in the mix with your top four guys coming in. At Rob Forte at a very quick pace, but Castillo was just grinding through these cleans a little bit faster than your top three guys. And it was pretty much those. You had Newberry, Forte, and Castillo. His rolls over the top on the runs back, a very quick, easy transition. And then it came down to that fourth round where Carroll moved up ahead at the bottom of your screen of Paul Castillo. But it was the technique and landing he was due over the hay bales, landing right on top, straddling that sandbag that made the difference for Carroll at the end.
You get to the end zone, you just want to spike something there as Jason Carroll leads the way, 17 minutes, 1.63 seconds, looking for what could be his second top 10 finish of the weekend as we start the final day with heat number 2 of 2 coming up next. We've changed the year, we've changed the venue, we've even changed the conditions on Matt Fraser, but 2016 and 2017 looked eerily similar. After 10 events, with one day remaining at the 2017 Reebok CrossFit Games, it's Matt Fraser out in front by 174 points over Noah Olsen, with Brent Fikowski holding on to that third and final podium position as we start the last day of competition with event number 11.
Starting off with some running, some cleans, some hay barrels, Throwing some burpees in there at the same time. Five rounds. It's just a long grinder. We had a short sprint grinder earlier with the assault bike and that banger. Now we're extending the time frame, but keeping the intensity.
One thing that Matt Fraser can't do is get taller. And with more on how height could affect the athletes in this one, we go to Sam Farber.
Size could certainly play a role in this event. Not so much for even the shorter athletes getting over 4 feet worth of hay bales, but it could become a contact sport if you're next to a taller athlete, like, say, Brett Fikowski at 6'2". I was talking to a member of the demo team, Graham Holmberg, six-time CrossFit Games competitor, and he recalled back in 2012 on the obstacle course accidentally kicking one of his fellow competitors in the face. Yes, sometimes the CrossFit Games are a contact sport.
Quite the height difference between Brent Fikowski and Matt Fraser, and it's also quite the points difference between them, first to third, 194 points. But here in heat number two, as they try to catch Jason Carroll's leading time, there's a few athletes that have a shot at it, and while Matt Fraser is putting the finishing touches on a second title, it's one of the other former champions in the field that you're keeping an eye on.
Well, I'm keeping an eye on because we finally get to see him again. Ben Smith has made his way back into the top 10. We haven't got to say his name a lot over the weekend, which is curious based off how the last 2 years have gone. Scott Pancheck, there he is, sitting in fifth overall. He was well outside the top 15 early on during these games. Now all the way back into the top five.
Day four of four is now underway with heat two of two in men's event number 11 as they try to catch Jason Carroll's time of 17 minutes, 1.63 seconds.
As he come off on the first start of this 450-meter run around the back parking lot of this field, I want to see two athletes kind of go head-to-head, and thankfully they're right next to each other, is how Matt Fraser is going to push the pace on the runs. So you see him in the mix with the white leader jersey, already moving up in the top five position. But can Brent Fikowski stay with him? Because I think Fikowski will be a little bit faster on the cleans. Fikowski, who won the 100% event last year at the Games, which involved 20 D-ball cleans at 150 pounds at the end of burpees over a box. So this is a good event for Brent Fikowski to maybe add to his win total. Race the run, and unfortunately, race the hay. There is no pacing necessarily involved, and what I mean by that is you can't run slow. I'm not saying go out to a dead sprint, but if you want to win, you're going to have to run faster than you want to. When you get to the field, you're going to have to not take as many breaks as you want to between cleans. You're going to have to race the entire time.
Making their way back to the stadium, Cody Anderson is the first one to the field, but he's going to have to make his way all the way across the field to get to his lane. But Ricky Garrard started in lane number 12, and he's actually gone around Cody Anderson to lead the way as they step back up onto the platform. And Garrard will be out in front by a pretty decent margin, getting to that 100-pound sandbag ahead of Noah Olsen in second, Matt Fraser in third, all three in lanes right there in the middle.
He's also wearing some gloves, and that can be an advantage, to, so to speak, because you're not going to like try to drag your hands on the hay or get your fingernails or stuff stuck in the turf. So Garrard's actually the only one out here using those gloves, and they can help with some grip as well, because with a 100-pound sandbag, it's not like the D-balls that they had at the Games last year or the 150-pound ones they had at regionals. You can just grab and throw with that 100 pounds, and those gloves can help that.
Leader's name currently Ricky Garrard will be highlighted in blue throughout this event. On the top of the screen, everybody else will be in red. If you see a number with a minus in front of it, that indicates how many reps they are behind the lead, which is continuing to be held by the Australian rookie, Ricky Garrard. Quick hop over the wall for Garrard, and Matt Fraser is right there with him, as is Jason Smith in all blue. So it'll be Garrard one, Fraser two, Jason Smith in third. And then there's about eight athletes leaving the platform all at the same time right behind them.
It's hard to kind of really get a feel for the field after the first round because they are so spread out on the floor. What I love about Ricky Garrard all weekend is that he came in as a rookie. And most times with especially rookie male athletes, say for Patrick Vellner and Brent Fikowski last year, is that it's tough for them to make a big splash here on the big scene. Ricky Garrard has took it to these top multiple games here athletes. He also hasn't backed off when he's taken some licks of his own. Now you have Matt Fraser sitting in second just behind Garrard. I like Garrard's tenacity all weekend long.
Garrard with a very impressive rookie year, and he's one or two strides ahead of somebody else that had a very impressive rookie year. Matt Fraser had back-to-back second place finishes before his championship win 1 year ago. At this point, after 10 events last year, he had 810 points, a 160-point lead over Ben Smith, who was in second place at the time, with one win over the course of that weekend. After 10 events this year, 850 points, three wins, and a 174-point lead over second place Noah Olsen. And here comes a field of 10 out of the field of 20, all within a handful of seconds of each other, back to the field to start round number two.
Garrard's in one of those early lanes. Fraser's just gonna be right next to him. And what I see, Garrard's just don't hesitate. Grab the bag, toss it over, burpee jump, land and grab. I hope that they can kind of saw what Jason Carroll did in the previous heat where he was landing right on top of it, straddling the bag, and that just, you're saving seconds over the course of this event.
Top 10, Ricky Garrard all the way back to 10th place. Cody Anderson all within 10 seconds of each other getting to their 100-pound sandbag. And in the middle, also in the mix, fifth to get to the sandbag was Noah Olsen. And we spoke about Matt Fraser's impressive rookie year and what he's done since then. For Noah Olsen, the last time we've seen him this high up in the point standings was in his rookie year when he was the points leader at the midway point.
And he had a fantastic rookie season in, falling out of that after a few events. And sometimes the moment can get too big. But Noah Olsen has had a wonderful career so far, this being his third year in a row. I like the way he's approached this year's games, where it's not just about going fast and going hard. He's been very conservative and smart in his competition so far.
Ricky Garrard already made it his way to the track, but Matt Fraser is just ahead of Patrick Vellner and Garrett Fisher. As they all make their way off the field, Jason Smith will be in fifth, just ahead of BK Goodmanson, Noah Olsen, and Brent Fikowski. Ricky Garrard has been definitely exciting here in his first weekend of games competition at this level. He's been a bit of a home run hitter. He's had some swing and misses, though, throughout the way. But when he connects, it's definitely got some power to it as he leads the way here in this heat as we're on the third 450-meter run of five. And this is still significantly ahead of the pace of Jason Carroll, who has the top time to beat of 17 minutes, 1 second.
And Ricky Garrard is slowly pulling away from Fraser as you see some of the athletes behind him with Vellner and Fisher and Jason Smith creeping a little bit closer to Matt. But I think that is playing to his strategy a bit as he works from round to round to round.
Garrard leading the way. He entered this event 24 points behind Brent Fikowski for third. Fikowski was just 2 points shy of that third position 1 year ago. Matt Fraser, he doesn't have a whole lot to worry about. 174 points clear of Noah Olsen in second.
But Fraser is doing exactly what he needs to do. And it's, you know, it's funny all the time, you know, we talk about some of the, one of the most second place finishes in events for Matt Fraser. But the deal is that the names above them when those events come by always are changing, just to show you the diversity of high level skill sets that Matt Fraser has accrued over the years. Just, you know, Sean Wooden said it best last year during the sprint. You know, there's nothing that Matt Fraser can't do. And it's not just do, there's nothing that he can't dominate. And dominate doesn't necessarily mean win every event, but taking second is a pretty good one too.
Fraser's tagline on social media posts is hard work pays off, and he's put in plenty of hard work as he looks to be wrapping up a second consecutive title. Of course, there's still more to come today, but he's in a solid position as we start the final day. And he's trying to hold off Patrick Vellner in the gray shirt on the left of the screen, who's battling with him for a second. Brent Fikowski, third in the point standings overall. He currently sits in seventh as they made their way back from that run.
Now, Fikowski is falling a little bit behind of your top six to seven guys. And it's really coming here on these burpees and cleans as he's kind of grabbing and rolling the sandbag, where you see Fraser and these other guys just throwing it as hard as they can. But I like what Fraser is doing, is he's landing side to side like we saw Jason Carroll do. He pushed the pace more that round than he did in the previous two.
14 seconds the differential now from Ricky Garrard in first to Vellner and Fraser, who are tight for second and third. And Patrick Vellner has moved ahead of Matt Fraser just by a few strides as they start round number four, well behind Ricky Garrard, who chose to get a little bit more aerodynamic on this fourth run of 450 meters by ditching the shirt.
And a lot of times in long events like this is that you talk about momentum, ebbs and flows throughout the weekend, not just with the field, but individually across the board. Ricky Garrard found himself all the way up in the top two at one point yesterday, but had a rough finish to the end of day on Saturday on the thrusters. He just said, it's like, I hate thrusters. So you were kind of, people might be curious, it's like, well, is he falling off? Is kind of that rookie wall starting to hit him? I think if there's any indication that he is not worried about how last night ended, the start of Sunday is the way to start things off for the fourth and final day.
And when you're a rookie, one of the questions is, you go to regionals, that's 3 days of competition. You don't often see four-day competitions. How will you handle that extra day of competing? And Ricky Garrard starting his fourth day very, very well.
And I think people who know their history is like, well, they've competed 4 days at the CrossFit Games before. Yes, they have, but traditionally they've had a rest day or maybe a singular event day on that Thursday where they've been starting on Wednesday. This is four consecutive straight days of competition. We're talking about hundreds, if not thousands, of reps that have gone by, from heavy lifting, light barbell cycling, endurance running, swimming, biking, climbing, moving odd objects up and down the field that weigh hundreds and hundreds of pounds. This is event 11 over the past 3 days. So it's just how impressive these athletes have been so far.
Garrard with those hurdles over those 50-inch tall hay bales. As Patrick Vellner starting to pull away a little bit from Matt Fraser. For Vellner, this could be big as he entered this event sixth in the point standings, trying to get back on the podium for a second straight year. But Ricky Garrard trying to do the same.
And I like what Garrard's doing in the front part of the hay barrels, is that when he lands, he doesn't try to slide the bag under his hands to get a better grip. He just grabs, stands, throws. That's what you want to see. If this were a heavier bag, then yes, the technique of kind of rolling it to one hand, pulling it to your hip, getting it over. You don't need to do that with a 100-pound bag. And that's, I think, where sometimes, as he is the only one wearing gloves, it does help because you're not worried about kind of, you know, sometimes a lot of times your fingernails can get caught underneath or hit the rubber if you're using the rubber floors. But that technique of being able to stand up, land right over the bag, grab and throw, that's where Ricky Garrard is really pulling away of everybody.
Ricky Garrard is starting round number five, but starting round number four back in the hay bale portion of this one is Noah Olson, who was one of the early leaders. He now finds himself in ninth place in this heat. And he's not safe on that podium battle, as he was only 44 points ahead of Ricky Garrard in fourth.
And we're looking at, what does that mean in terms of finishing places in events like this? And we're looking at the scoring system. It rewards winning. We're talking about 100 points to the winner, and they decrease in reps beyond that. If you were to get 10th place in this event, which is a fantastic finish at the CrossFit Games, you're going to lose 40 points to whoever won the heat. So if Ricky Garrard can get 100 points and Noah Olsen has a great finish of 10, he'll only be 4 points behind him after one event.
Last round underway. Jason Carroll, who has the event lead at 17:01, he started his last round right now. Ricky Garrard's already through half of this 450-meter run and about 200 meters clear of Patrick Vellner in second.
Now, I thought Fikowski was really falling back, but he's just behind Matt Fraser in the blue and yellow shorts. So Fikowski, which seemed like he started slow, but you know, he knows his pace and how to race, and you'll probably see him push hard coming into this final round. So Brent Fikowski has moved back up into contention here.
Top five rounded out by Bjorgvin Carl Gudmundsson, who you saw behind Fikowski a moment ago. This the race for second through fifth, currently held by Patrick Vellner, Matt Fraser in the white leader's jersey in third. But Ricky Garrard, he could look behind him, he could look around all day, and he won't see anybody around him as Noah Olsen just starting his last round as he continues to fade. He's now down to 12th, but Ricky Garrard is just putting on a show to start day number four.
I mean, nothing like a fist bump coming into this stage out here.
Whoa, that could have been pretty bad as he rolled his ankle a little bit running over those mats. Looks to be all right as he's hopping over those hay bales with relative ease. They're over 4 feet tall. Maybe minus an inch or two at this point with all the compression, but.
And I just love the non-hesitation when it comes to just grabbing, cleaning, and throwing. Just brute grunt work right there. He's been doing this stuff all weekend long. I just love the tenacity we've been getting from Ricky Garrard. What a surprise.
This will be 4 reps out of 7 for Garrard. Vellner, Fraser, and Fikowski just now got back to the field. Ricky Garrard won cyclocross in impressive fashion. He's doing the same to start day number four and way ahead of second place in the point standings, Noah Olsen. It's an event win, and it's a gigantic points win for the super rookie out of Australia, Ricky Garrard.
To put 100 points in the Ricky Garrard bank, as we are going to have to start watching how people finish between him and Noah Olsen. Fikowski, who is sitting in third, is trying to stay with Fraser and keep that third place position. Vellner is making a push just above them in the gray and yellow too.
Important to note, we're still 45 seconds away of Jason Carroll's time, which is the fastest in heat number one. And the pace is picking up for both Fikowski in blue, Vellner in gray, Fraser in white. They're all working on their final rep. Give the edge in the position of Vellner in second. Fraser will be in third. And Brent Fikowski will finish fourth in the heat and fourth in the event. 24-point edge for Fikowski over Ricky Garrard. He'll lose 16 of them here in this event, so it'll be 8 points the difference there. But more importantly for Ricky Garrard's podium hopes, where is Noah Olsen? Jason Smith looking to be our next finisher as Travis Mayer has just crossed the line at 17:01.04, good for sixth best, just ahead of Jason Carroll's event one time. Jason Smith in at 17:07. Logan Collins will finish in eighth as we watch Ben Smith, the 2015 Games champion. A couple of reps remain for him. He's not sitting in a good position. Neither is Scott Panchik. And we always joke, no matter what you do to him, he's going to finish fourth, fifth, or sixth at the Games. He's done it 5 consecutive years. But he's going to take a points hit here this time.
Now he's sitting in fifth after this event as him and Ben Smith are side by side. We're hoping to see Panchik at least hold on to that position, maybe have an opportunity to move up.
Speaking of points hits, Ben Smith just ahead of Noah Olsen in all blue. So Noah 15th in the heat, 26th in the event. And what do you get for that finish? 28 points.
Talking about a 72-point difference between Ricky Garrard and Noah Olsen in one single event. So when you guys think it's all over when they're up by 50 points, so many different things can happen in a single event. Nothing is for certain here.
Even worse, when you're looking at the top five hopes and podium hopes of Scott Panchik, he only gets 20 points as he finishes 30th in this event. So we have a minute, 20 seconds remaining. Lucas Esslinger has crossed the line. Cole Sager will be our final athlete left as he's working on his last rep. And you see the destruction of athletes in the end zone that have finished this event. And this is just the start of the last day of competition. So the Madison triplet on the women's side, it couldn't have been a whole lot better for Tia Claire Toomey. On the men's side, it definitely couldn't have been better for Ricky Garrard.
When he's, like I said, he had a second place podium position going into the day yesterday and had a big loss of points when we finished out last night in the heavy 17.5. Well, how do you make that up? Well, you start fast, you even continue the pace through, and Ricky Garrard just never let off the gas. He was first in the hay bales after round one, and once he got to round two and three, he just continued to move that or open up that lead. Noah Olsen, who has made it all the way back up into second place after last night, and it seemed like he had a comfortable point lead, that has now been all but erased. Felder, and we hadn't said his name much, he's been creeping around, sitting in that sixth place position, getting himself a second place finish. We're talking about it pays to be a winner with this scoring system. 100 points is huge, especially on the last day of competition.
So Ricky Garrard, not many rookies will get multiple event wins in a single games weekend. Garrard has done just that. The winner of cyclocross is also the winner of the Madison triplet by nearly 40 seconds over Patrick Vellner, and Matt Fraser will continue to have that gigantic points lead as he takes third.
And I like the way it started because it's mild amount of chaos. And Matt Fraser, regardless of what you can throw out there, whether it's heavyweight, short events, long events, different types of monostructural running, swimming, rowing, throw the elements at this guy, and he still extends his lead over the rest of the field by tens of points on the leaderboard.
Yeah, Matt Fraser is proving to basically be a cyborg at this point in his career. 198 points is the lead for Fraser over Fikowski, but only 36 points separate Fikowski, Garrard, who's now in third, and Noah Olsen, who fell all the way from second down to fourth in the point standings, with Patrick Vellner closing the gap as well. But the big winner here in this event is the event winner, Ricky Garrard, who's with Sam Farber.
Ricky, the win here in the Madison triplet, dealing with some odd objects. You're a head trainer back in Australia. How much work do you have your clients doing with hay bales?
Oh, none at all, to be honest. A little bit of hay bales growing up on the farm, but it was bringing back some memories. And I felt great out there.
Definitely going to be some fun ones now. It's your second event win. You're a games rookie. What were your goals as you came here to Madison for what you wanted to accomplish, either in terms of event wins or the overall competition?
Deep down, I think I deserve a top five finish. But I'm in it. I'm hungry. I want that podium, and I'm going to fight right to the end.
Right now, Ricky, you're on the podium. You don't know what's ahead of you. What is the key to staying there?
Just stay calm, stay relaxed like I have been. Don't get caught up in the moment. Just take it one workout at a time. I'm ready for whatever Dave throws at us. I've done the preparation. I've put in the hard work. So bring it on.
It's always fun to see what Dave throws at you. Good luck out there.
Thanks, man.
I think it's one of those, be careful what you wish for. Bring it on, he says to Dave Castro. Ricky Garrard, that is one heck of a way to start day number four, sitting himself back up into the podium position. Got a lot left. We don't even know what some of these events are going to be.
We don't know what's left, but we know what's going on, and that's Matt Fraser continuing to lead the way, a 198-point lead as we continue day number four.